This week's parasha, Chaya Sarah, the life of Sarah, ironically talks about the death of Sarah. Like we find also by Chi Yaakov, this is the life of Yaakov, and it immediately discusses its death. Now the rabbis tell us, Tzadikim b'misasam nikra chayim. Righteous people, even after they pass on, are considered living. Because someone who lives a life of masim tovim, of good deeds, does mitzvahs, and does chesed, acts of loving kindness, and helps others, and makes an impact on others, so that impact remains even after that person moves on, because you affected many people, and therefore they live their life differently. Like you learn the Rambam comes alive every day when a person learns the Rambam or Rashi. In fact, interesting, that tells there's a minhag when people go to the cemetery, whether it's when they're putting up the monument, the matseva, or just for a visit during the year, to visit their loved ones, some of them mimic to put a stone on top of the matseva, the monument. What's that all about, the stone? So the different reasons given, historically speaking, some explain that they didn't have the big stones like we have now. So they used to do, after the burial, they used to put a pile of stones to keep the animals away. And every time they used to come back, every couple of months, once a year, once a month, whatever your custom is, they used to go and put stones back in order to keep the animals away. So if that's the case, then there really is no basis for putting stones on today, because we have big monuments. However, others explain differently. The number one, the rock in Hebrew is Sur, and therefore, that's also an allusion to the name of God. And therefore, to realize that a person is never alone, that you're coming, we're coming to visit you, God's with you, even after one's death, we still consider living. And others explain differently as well, along our lines, that a rock is something eternal. The rock is something that stays forever. So to speak, when you put the rock on top of the monument, it's true that person is no longer with us, but the impact on us, that remains forever like a rock. And that's why it says, we say in our davening on the Yomim Noraim, on Rosh Hashanah, on Yom Kippur, the Sifrei Chayim and the Sifrei Mesim are opened up. The books of the living, as well as the books of the dead, are opened. I understand the books of the living. You live the whole year, you have to give an accounting, God's going to decide what's going on. But the books of the dead, a person's been dead 25 years, you're still opening up the book, like what could he have done in the grave for the past 25 years? And the answer is, the impact he had on others, he still reaps the rewards. So, for instance, of Aaron Cutler, who started Lakewood Yeshiva with a couple of students, now it's the biggest yeshiva in the world, and plus the fact Lakewood's all over, so Rav Aaron Cutler gets all the reward for everything that's going on, Rav Salavitcher, all of his students, etc. That Bayu Chaye Sarah, it's the life of Sarah, the legacy of Sarah continues. And that's why we see the Torah spends so much time on looking for a shidduch for Yitzchak. He tells Eliezer, Avram gives his servant Eliezer all the details. The Torah is usually very concise. It goes about 60 psukim working on emphasizing, I need someone with chesed, I need someone from here. Why so particular and looking specific things? Because Avram realized his whole life he's working to create a legacy, not in a selfish way, in a good way. And because he knows that the nation, the Jewish people have to continue, and he has to ensure that for his son Yitzchak, he gets the appropriate wife. So the Torah goes into great detail explaining why it's so important. That's why also, at the end of the parasha, it just has this talks about all the different encampings of other nations, and so that's not what it's all about. But the Rav explains with Soloveitchik, the Haftorah at the end of the parasha talks about when King David is on his deathbed. King David's on his deathbed, so they point out that he gives directions to Shlomo in terms of what the do's and don'ts. And we always look for a connection between the Haftorah and the parasha. That's it. That Avram looking for a shidduch for Yitzchak, and King David giving over to his son, is that you always realize you're not just living for yourself, but you're living for others, and there's a legacy you have to protect. And that's what it's saying here. But Yuchayei Sarah, it was the life of Sarah. She kept on living well after the time she passed away. And it's interesting and famous Rashi. The Torah says that she died at 127 years. But it uses a very interesting language. It says, Sarah's lifetime was 100 years, 20 years, and 7 years. Shnei Chayei Sarah, the years of Sarah's life. The years of Sarah's life. A lot of redundancies here, it would seem. So Rashi already points out, the famous Rashi, why is it split up? Why say 100 years, 20 years? So Rashi explains that he divides Sarah's life into three periods, each with its own uniqueness. So one is at 100 she was as sinless as a 20-year-old. Why? What's so special about 20-year-olds? For until an age of 20, a person does not suffer heavenly punishment. There's a discussion in the Mefarshim, at 13 and 12 you become obligated in mitzvahs, but perhaps in terms of punishment, maybe you need about 7-8 years in order to prepare yourself to mature enough to be responsible. And at age 20, she still had the wholesome beauty of a 7-year-old who does not use cosmetics and whose beauty is natural. So that's how Rashi splits it up. 100 years, she was like sinless as 20, and it's 20, she was like a beautiful, wholesome 7-year-old. I guess apparently those days 7-year-olds look very good. So then, and also Rashi writes, Shnei Chayei Sarah. So Rashi writes, Kuan Shavim Latova. All 127 years were good. So it seems like a very difficult Rashi if you've been paying attention the last couple of weeks when we read the Parsha. Sarah was blessed with a son like Yitzchak, but that didn't happen right away. She went through a hard time trying to become pregnant. She was barren for a long time. And to put insult to injury, when she sent Avram to go have a child from a maidservant, the maidservant gave birth right away. It had to be hurtful to Sarah. And as well, she experienced the famine and hunger. And of course, let's not forget, she was kidnapped twice. So what do you mean, Kulan Shavua Tova? That doesn't mean that her whole life was just all good. And what's the splitting up of years? So Rav Soloveitchik has a beautiful explanation from Reflections of the Rav, pages 88, and I'll just read for you a couple of lines. At different stages of life, people naturally possess different strengths and are inclined towards the different forms of accomplishment. The personality of someone when he or she is young is different than what the same person is when they are older. Generally speaking, there are always exceptions to the rule. Generally speaking, in our younger years, we are more passionate, idealistic, and open to change. Usually when you're younger, you're idealistic, you're looking, you're searching, you're looking for change. As we advance in age, hopefully, we acquire wisdom and perspective. And in the Rav's words, the child is endowed with a capacity of an all-absorbing faith and trustfulness. Youth bursts with zealousness, idealism, and optimism. the adult mellowed with years has the benefit of accumulated knowledge and not dispassionate judgment. But the point being is, at different times of our life, when we were younger, we're more open, we're more eager, and older, hopefully, we have more wisdom and more perspective. In fact, there's a famous maisa, they say, over with the Satmar Rebbe. One of his chassidim, I guess he was learning Pirkei Avos, chapter that with fathers, and then he was getting to the Mishnah. I think it says, was it 60 or 70? I forget, I have to look. Ben Shishim with Zikna. When you turn 60 or 70, it's you're getting old. So he went to the Rebbe, he's very concerned. Look what the Mishnah says. Look, I'm an old man, I'm getting old. So the Rebbe said to him, don't worry. It also says, Ben Arbam Uchachma. It also says that 40. You're going to get wisdom, and that didn't happen either. But either way, so we see from here that people have, younger people, idealism, change, etc., passion, and older people as well, but it's more accumulated knowledge, perspective. So that's what the Rav Soloveitchik is explaining, that she, even in her young age, she had the ability of also, besides the rigor and the passion, she had perspective. And similarly, when she got older, besides the perspective, she had the zealous. So she combined both her qualities of youth and old age all in one. In fact, that's what the pshat is in the Rashi. Kulan shavu atov. It doesn't mean everything that happened into her life was good. No, but she was able to incorporate into her life her qualities from youth and zikna and old age, and be able to combine them into kulan shovu latova, to keep things in balance and proportion. And in fact, that's how Rav, the Sri Deish, Rav Weinberg says in the Pshat in the Gemara in Bava Kama, 97b, that it says, the Gemara says, that Avram had his own currency, which on one side had an elderly man and woman, and on the other side of the coin had a young boy and girl. So what's the pshat? Avram wasn't a king, like he was able to go ahead and just make up his currency. So no, so Rechiel Weinberg explains, no, it's the same he sold. He was able to, as the Rav explains, he was able to play both sides of the coin. His energy in his youth, along with maturity, he was able to combine it. That's Kulan Shavu Atova. So that's a nice, interesting explanation from Rav Soloveitchik. So we wanted to continue her legacy, and she used all her kochos for both young and old. And the next pasuk says, Vatamas Sarah Bekiryas Arba Hi Hevron Bieritz Kanan. Vayavo Avraham Lispod Lisara of Kolza. So Sarah died, Bekiryas Arba Hi Hevron. So the Chazal tell us, what's the juxtaposition, the connection between the end of the last week's parsha, Akedas Yitzchak, that Avram brought Yitzchak almost for a karban, and the beginning of this week's parasha, the death of Sarah. So Chazal tell us, to teach us, that she died as a result of that event. The Medrash says, and she was told that by the Satan, that Avram actually slaughtered Yitzchak, and she cried out in grief and died. So Parcha Neshama, so that's what it's, that's what Rashi says. Nisbacha Misa Sarah Lakeda Si. It's called Kavisha Yide Bisara Sakeda Shinizdamaba Vishita Ukumachiro Nishkot. And he was almost killed. Parcha Nishmas Menu Mesa. So what's the Pshat? So obviously you only die when it's your time. But what's the Pshat here that Sarah, when she heard about the news of the Akedah, that she died? What do you mean? You mean, as Rav Sternbuch asked in the Tam Vadas, he says, let me read his Russian, Yesh lid moa asitkanias kisara, sabadagam hi haisa, mukhuna lakayim siva Hashem Avraham, v'lama im kain parkanishmasi. What do you mean? In fact, we know What do you mean? Sarah was upset at Avraham for bringing Yitzhak on the Akedah? She didn't want it to happen? In fact, we know Sarah was a greater prophet than Avraham. So what's the pshat here? So there's a beautiful explanation in his Talmudas. V'niru levar hadvarim al pi, I want to explain on the following. You notice the Magid Meisharim, that's when the angels, that's the sefer from the Beis Yosef, that he says he went to sleep with questions and he had answers in the morning. So he writes that one time he was told in his dream, he was once told in his dream of Yosef Cairo, besides writing the Shulchan Aruch, he spoke with angels, that he's going to die a life at Kiddush Hashem. So he says, if a Sof Yamav, Tama Beis Yosef, he wanted to know, but what happened? I didn't die at Kiddush Hashem. What are you talking? Why did you mess me over? The Hamagid Heshivlo, Shehu Zocha, Zocha Mitzvah Gedola Yotir. You know something? You merit even a greater schar, a greater mitzvah. What could be greater than Akiddush Hashem? The Hainu Lichyos Akiddush Hashem, to live a life of Kiddush Hashem. The Bamisa Moser Nafsho Pamachas, not to downplay it, and Lo Aleinu, but to die Akiddush Hashem, you only get a one-time shot. You only can die once. Gam Bechayav Moser Nafsho. But when you're living, Moser Nafsho Yomi Yom, the Kayim Ritzono. But to live a life at Kiddush Hashem, that's a day in and day out thing. V'tzara istara shol zachsa shebena yikadei shem shamayim mechayev. And Sarah, you know why she was upset? The opposite. She heard that Yitzchak's going to die at Kiddush Hashem. I want my son to have a greater mitzvah. I want him to live at Kiddush Hashem. Shezu madrega gavoa yotir. Meilak in the Akedah. Umirov Sar Parchan, and because of her Tsar that she thought he was going to be killed, that's why from all of the stress on the Shama left. And that's why perhaps he writes Venera, Shemitam Zel O Gila Avram Avino with Sarah. Maybe that's why we know there was a lot of communication between Avram and Sarah. Sarah told her to have someone else to another kid. We know with Yitzchak and Rivka, the way Rav Hirsch explains, there was a communication gap. They weren't, the one was totally different backgrounds, etc. That's why Rivka couldn't just tell him, like, don't give the brachas to Esav and other things. But there was communication between Avram and Sarah. So how come Avram didn't tell Sarah where he was going? Sarah should have been happy. Sheyadua shehu, because he thought shehi tispal Allah. He thought that Sarah would want to daven against the Gzeirah because she wanted her son to live a life of Kiddush Hashem. And therefore, and Avraham Avinu didn't want to have any cheshbonos. He says, that's what you wanted, so that's what I'll do. I didn't want to have to pray. I don't want to push the envelope, even though I prefer my child to live out Kiddush Hashem. If you tell me I have to do it, I'm going to do it. So we see there's a tremendous mitzvah of dying al Kiddush Hashem, perhaps even not that you necessarily have a choice, but the mitzvah of living al Kiddush Hashem, sanctifying God's name every day, that's even a greater mitzvah. And in fact, that's what they point out. There's a famous Shemen HaTov. The Shemen HaTov points out that whatever happened to Yitzchak, we know this whole parsha, the death of Sarah, he's not at the funeral, he hasn't come to his mother's funeral. The whole parsha, when Abram's telling Ezer, find a shidduch for Yitzchak, Yitzchak's not involved, like he doesn't want to have any eitzahs, any advice for Eliezer. What happened to him? So the Medrash tells us that the same thing Yaakov was doing in the womb when he was fighting with Esav, that's what Yitzchak went. Yitzchak went to learn in the yeshiva of Shem Ve'Ever, which is the famous yeshiva during that time. The question is, what do you mean? What does he have to learn? He's reached the peak. He was willing to give his life al Kiddush Hashem. So what's more to learn? So the Shema Tov answers, Hawa Yisod. It's one thing to die al Kiddush Hashem, but now I have to learn how to live al Kiddush Hashem. And dying al Kiddush Hashem is a one-time shah, but to live al Kiddush Hashem, that's a day-in, day-out thing. And in fact, that's what we could also explain. There's a famous question they ask, that when the Torah introduces Avraham, Lech lecha meyartzecha, go out to a land and I'll show you, etc. But we all know a tremendous event that happened before by Or Kostim, when God came down to Abraham in Or Kostim and he was going to jump in the fiery furnace and give up his life al Kiddush Hashem. So why didn't he, why did the Torah tell us about this? The Torah Shabbat, the Orwa tells us, but you would think, what's my introduction to Avram? Not Lech Lecha, but it should be, wow, what a tremendous person Avram is. He was willing to go al Kiddush Hashem. And the answer is, that no, that's not what God wants. As you have to do it, if you're in a situation of Kiddush Hashem, you'll do it. But the litmus test of a Jew is, Lech Lecha Kasher Tziva Hashem, that you live a life at Kiddush Hashem, and you go out Lech Lecha, and you go spread ethical monotheism, that's even a greater level. And the Torah doesn't go into the Or Kostim, it will be very heroic and tremendous effort, but nevertheless, what the Torah is emphasizing is a Torah Chayim. Other religions beautify death. In Judaism, we beautify life. Life, that's what it's all about. And of course, if you die al-Kiddush Hashem, it's a great tzchus. But living al-Kiddush Hashem, day in, day out, that's even a higher madrigal. And that's what the Sukkot David explains. That's why the Torah begins with Lech Lecha, and not with Or Kostim. That's why right after al-Kiddush, Yitzchak Yitzchak goes to learn v'shem v'ever. And that's what the angel told the Beis Yosef, you're even on a higher level. The Zoch al Kiddush Hashem, you get to live a life of Kiddush Hashem. And that's what Sarah wanted. She wasn't upset because he was giving up his life. He was upset because it's a greater mitzvah to live a life of Kiddush Hashem. And we see that throughout. That's why we know when a would-be ger, a would-be convert, comes to you and says, you know, they want to convert, you have to go through all the details. So the Gemara says, you tell them mitzvahs, mitzvahs, kalos, v'chamurus. You tell them about a widow, you tell them about some difficult mitzvahs and some easy mitzvahs. So the question is, if he's willing to keep the difficult mitzvahs, why do you have to know about the easy ones? Because sometimes, as Rav Desur explains, based on the Gemara, Gemara Avodah Zarah, where Yossi ben Kisma fell ill, and one of the rabbis came to visit him, and they said to him, he rebuked him and said, what are you doing teaching Torah of a rabbi, teaching Torah in public? You're putting your life in danger, we need you. He begged for his mercy, and he said, Rebbe, why be zocha to olam habo? I merit the next world. So he said, tell me what you've done. He said, well, one time in my life, I remember it was Purim time and I mixed up some charity money with my Purim Suda, and I gave all the couple of extra dollars to Sadaka. So Rabbi Yosef said, wow, you did that? May my lot be like your lot. If you were only able to do that, then I hope to get the same olam haba you get. The question is obvious. This person risked his life al Kiddush Hashem to teach Torah, and yet he's praising him on some seemingly trivial thing. As Rav Desler explains, because real greatness of character is shown on the everyday things. That's when you get to really know a person. People get moved by different special situations and they rise above. but it's the everyday things. That's what a person gets tested on. And that's why the Gemara tells us. One who says Ashrei three times a day is Zocha to Olam Haba, merits the world to come. But one who says Hal every day is like you're cursing out God. The question is, they both come from the book of Tehillim. How come if I do one, I'm great, I do the other one, I'm terrible? And the answer is, Hallel is over supernatural miracles. You get moved by Nisim, and God, if you do a miracle, then I'll be good. So people have miracles happen, special things happen, and people are moved. But that's the only time you see God in miracles, you're missing the boat, you're a blasphemer. Ashrei is in the form of Aleph, Beis, Gimel, Dalet, Hey. You see God in the everyday things. That's the highest level. That's when Miyaleh Bahar Hashem, we say, who could rise the mountain of God? For me, Yaakov Mekogosh, who could stay up there? That's the highest level. And that's the Pshah, different opinions. What's the most important pasuk in the Torah? One opinion is the Karban Tamid you bring. I understand Shema Yisrael, we have to Shem Olkecha, but the Karban Tamid, the answer is because it's a day in, it's a continuous offering today, every day of the year. And no matter what, no matter how you feel, how good you are, you're willing to do it. That's why they point out, and someone who goes to a, they talk about an Adam Kosher. What's a kosher, Adam Kosher? So, we know there's a concept of a trefa, that an animal is going to die within 12 months. So Adam Kosher, the Avnei Nezer points out, is someone during all times of season, spring, summer, fall, whether it's good time, bad times, difficult times, like the Nebuchadnezzar, they say, he was about to sing a shira that was going to put David and Melech to shame. A malach came and hit him and gave him pachi, and then he stopped. The answer is, what happened to free choice? Why is he, if he could write better than David, let him write better? And the answer is, no one stopped him. He just gave him a patch. It's one thing if he's sitting on the beach with the guitar and the music and the wind, nice breeze coming by, you get in the mood. Maybe you could sing some good songs and write some good lyrics. But David HaMelech, what's the greatest of Tehillim? It's when he wrote it. He's running away from his son, he's running away from Shaul. One sorry after another, and if you can write to him then, that's the godless of David HaMelech. And that's what it's all about, living a life of Kiddush Hashem. And as we see, Sarah was able not only to live a life of Kiddush Hashem, but Yosho died of Kiddush Hashem as well, by Yuchaye Sarah. She continued living. Today we still learn the lessons of Sarah. And even just like during her lifetime, she was able to combine the rigor and the passion and the idealism of youth with the maturity and perspective of old age or older, becoming older and wiser. So too, we all learn from Sarah. We try to combine all the good qualities. Kulan Shava Watova. We all have different tragedies and different setbacks, but the trick is to take all the positive things of youth and old age and put them together and use both qualities. All is over. And that's the Pshah, Yuchaye Sarah, that Sarah continues living even today. So we'll discuss this morning a little about the mitzvah of burial and eulogy. In fact, there's a Maisaf, my friend told me that he was visiting Rav Ashri. Rav Ashri was one of the great rabbis who survived the Kovno ghetto during the Nazis, and he was living on the east side of Manhattan. And he went to visit him, I guess, later on in life, and he asked him, did you hear about Rabbi X who passed away? And he said to him, Was he zocher to a Jewish funeral? In other words, things we take for granted, that we're going to have a Jewish funeral today, being buried in a Jewish cemetery, that was far from simple years ago, especially during the Holocaust and other times. And we saw from reading how important it was to Avraham Avinu. He spent all that time with Ephron, all that money, in order to ensure that Sarah had a Jewish funeral or the cemetery, because we retain our identity even after our death. In fact, that's why the Salvation used to speak many times about that an American soldier should not be buried in the Arlington Cemetery, which is the cemetery for soldiers, because he felt the important need to be buried in a Jewish cemetery, which is halacha. So we'll discuss a little bit about that. So the Gemara tells us in Sanhedrin, first it discusses the issue of a eulogy, as well Sarah. Avram also gave a eulogy on Sarah as well. Maybe that's not the source of eulogies, but we learn out different things. But Avram, lispo l'sara l'fkosa.
Excuse me, what is the source of eulogies?
We'll get to it. We'll see first if it's biblical or rabbinical. What I mean, it's not the source of eulogies. Not that it wasn't the first one, is, as I mentioned many times, we don't do it because of Avram Avinu. Not that we, historically speaking, we could learn it from attitudes, but we have to see what was given in Har Sinai. So it's only a rabbinical obligation, so we go from there. But the Gemara discusses what is the purpose of a eulogy. So the Gemara's language is it basically, I'll paraphrase the Gemara's language, is it, who's it benefiting? Is it kavod hachai or kavod hames? Is it basically for the people living that they need, it's therapeutic, they have to talk about the person who passed away? Well, no, that's not the main purpose of a eulogy. The main purpose of a eulogy is for the person who passed away. It's passing away, so you want to say nice words and different things about the nifter. In fact, certain, among some Hasidish circles, they don't even do eulogies because they feel it's Ryan. I guess it's with Sarah Hashir. Hello? Sure. Someone has to go to the back to let him in. So,
he doesn't know that the back is locked always.
So, I didn't realize the recording stops when you pick up the phone.
Oh, that's good. Start over?
It started by itself, but
do you want to start the show so you can have the whole thing for your kosher to?
No, it's okay. They'll take that. Didn't stop anyway.
Okay.
So they point out that they don't, in Hasidic circles, they didn't. They don't give you, and again, not all Hasidic circles, because they feel you can't give a eulogy properly, and therefore you can't give a eulogy properly, better not to give it at all. Which isn't so simple, because then that means you're basically not fulfilling the mitzvah of eulogy, certainly. At least if you try to give a eulogy, maybe you'll be successful, maybe you won't be. But, you know, because there's different halachas about you can't, you know, don't overdo it. In terms of, sometimes I'm at a funeral, I hear a eulogy, I'm wondering who the person was, because it's not the person I know. So obviously sometimes you exaggerate too much, it becomes a mockery. That's what the halacha is concerned with. You have to have a balance. As the Taz says, person is usually, there's a little subjectivity, because if you don't like someone, you look at it one way. If you like someone, the same person, you say, there's always ways to, you could exaggerate without exaggerating. The person's always better than you think he is in terms of that. So, our custom is we have a eulogy, and the issue in the Gemara is who's for benefit. So, the Gemara always asks, "My nafkamina, what's the practical difference? Who cares if I say eulogy is honor to the dead, honor to the living? Either way, I have to give a eulogy." So is there any practical difference? So Gemara gives a couple of differences. One is, who has to pay for the different, there are people who, during the time of the Gemara, they used to pay people who created the mood for the eulogy. Like, you know, I always compare it to when you saw on those old movies, like these black women like singing, and you had these funerals and like making these different music, but whatever it was at that time, there were certain people who did the music or sang or got you into the mood of a eulogy. So the question was, who has to pay for them? If it's honor to the dead, so then you have to take it out of the inheritance. If it's honor to the living, well, if you want to have it, you go ahead and pay for it. But Or a more fundamental question is, do I have a right to say no eulogy? Does a person have a right to forego his own eulogy? Obviously, once you're dead, you don't have much of a say in the matter. And I'd say if someone came to you after you died not to give a eulogy, I might take it a little more seriously. But if someone left while he was alive said not to give a eulogy, so are you obligated to listen? Do you have to? Or you could just ignore his wishes? So, again, this depends on this issue. If the purpose of the eulogy is for people alive, therapeutic, to talk about it, it's part of their process, so then if it's for them, then he has no right to tell them no. But if the issue is kavod hameis, honor for the one who passed away, so then he has a right to say thanks, but no thanks. How do we paskin? Do we assume a person has the right to forego the eulogy or not?
Depends on the person.
What?
Depends on the person.
No, I mean, if the person says he... Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so what do you mean it depends on the person?
In other words, if the person was a halachic giant or something like that, and he tells us no, well, it's too important for the people to eulogize him, to remember him, and so on.
Correct, very good. So strictly speaking, as Jeff says, I need a stirrer. Strictly speaking, as Jeff says, that really one has a right to forgo the eulogy. In other words, it's for me, and if I thanks, but no thanks, I don't want a eulogy. Either whatever the reason, you don't think they're going to give a proper one, you think they're going to overdo, whatever your reasons are, you have a right to say no eulogy. However, as Jeff points out, if it's a gadol hador, a great rabbi, or if it's a matter of king, because the Navi tells us, by Shaul HaMelech, that the Jewish people were punished because they didn't eulogize Shaul properly. That's what the Pasuk says in Navi. The Jewish people were punished because they didn't give Shaul a proper eulogy. So is that a proof for Kavod HaMeis or Kavod HaChai? So if it's Kavod HaMeis, so I understand. If it's honor to the dead and they didn't take care of Shaul, then I understand why they were punished. So that seems to be a proof for Kavod HaMeis. But if it's Kavod HaChai, if it's for me, then why should we get punished? That's what the Mefarshim say, because there's certain people that it's more than just a person. Like the king, by not giving a eulogy, so it's a bizayon. It's not just not giving a eulogy, but he's the king of the Israel Melech, and there's many special halachas of honor we give to a king. So a king, if you don't give a... Even for a normal person, you could say it is kavod achai, but in the case of a king, we don't permit you because of the stature of the king. It's the institution of malchus. We're giving kavod to, like we explain many times. Let's say someone walks into a synagogue, a shul. You don't know who they are. It's like the first time you've seen them, and it's a Monday, Thursday, Shabbos, and you go over and you ask them, like, "Is there any kohanim in the house? Is there a kohen in the house?" And the guy says, "Yeah, okay." So you call him up, you give him a kohen, and you find out later on he was lying. He really wasn't a kohen. He never got that first aliyah. He was just dying to say he was a Kohen one time. So the halach is, you didn't do anything wrong. We fulfilled our mitzvah, because the mitzvah is v'kidashto, is to give. Why does the Kohen go first? We give kavod to the institution of kahuna. So that's what we did. So he said he was a Kohen. I don't really care if you're a Kohen or not. You tell me you're a Kohen, that's my mitzvah. That's why I say for benching, one of the things you're supposed to give is you give the kiddushah, you give kavod to the kohen. I always emphasize to the kohen, it's not your kavod I'm interested in, it's the institution of the kahuna, that you're in the family of kahuna, so therefore that demands that you get a certain type of respect. The same thing here, a king, a melech, it's someone who can't even be mocho on his honor, and certainly we can't, because it'd be closer to a bizayon. You do something which is normally done, and you don't do it for the king. That's why the Jewish people were punished for not eulogizing Shaul properly. And in fact, that's why the famous Maisa with Pnei Yoshua, one of the great rabbis, he left in his Sava, he left in his will, do not give me a eulogy. I do not want one.
And he said, why?
Different speculations why. And the Noda Behuda got up and he didn't care. He gave a eulogy anyway. He said, no, it's Kavod HaTorah. He was one of the Torah giants. For an average person, he or she has a right to say no eulogy. But if it's a Kohen, a Gadol Hador, a king, or not any Kohen, but in general, someone who's not just the average person, he has a major position, prominent, and by not doing it, it's not just not giving kavod, it'll be look like a bizayon, it'll look like a disgrace, so therefore, we pass, and you don't listen. So as a general rule, you have a right to say no eulogy, and we respect your wishes, and you don't have to give a eulogy. And however, for special, for a king, or someone in a prominent position, or one of the great rabbis, then even if they say no, many rabbis felt that they're not going to listen to them because it's the institution of Torah we're concerned about. And that's why many times as well, depending where you are, there's some certain times it's a custom not to give a eulogy. Might be on a Chol HaMoed or Rosh Chodesh. So therefore, depending where you are, you know, if you're in New York or Toronto, so everyone knows the halachas and they know, but you're in a place where it's going to be taken as a bizayon. They're like, what's going on here? Like, no eulogy. So you don't give a eulogy, you just talk about praise of the person. You know, since it's only a custom not to, so you have to know, as always, you have to know where you are and how it's going to be taken by the people by not giving a eulogy. And you have, you know, obviously the local, the more the Asher, the Rav will have to make that decision. Yeah.
In other words, there's an individual who is looked upon as the tzibur, the embodiment of the tzibur, the embodiment of Knesset Yisroel. That takes on already a different dimension. In other words, all those dimensions that Rav Selevan mentioned are obvious and clear. That's the halacha. So what I'm just adding is, when do you violate, not violate, when do you transcend those obvious codified halachas? Is when, if it's a covet of the seed of Melech, doesn't refer to himself. Melech refers to the state. The Gadol Hador was not only the a posek, but he represents Knesset Yisroel on the highest level. That would also apply with the Sanhedrin, members of the Sanhedrin, because the members of Sanhedrin, Shluchi Amcha Beis Yisroel, they represent the Shluchi Amcha Beis Yisroel, the agents for Am Yisrael. That's why prime minister, a president, will have to take on different halachas when that comes. So I think that is the dimension that takes on differently.
You're right.
My experience was that someone could say, I'm not going to give a eulogy, but if I was going to give a eulogy, this is what I would say.
Right, that's when a person would say, or in a situation where when you're not supposed, right?
I don't want a eulogy, but if there were one, this is
what I would say about me.
Right, so along these lines, we have a similar halacha. So the Gemara tells us that when Yeshua was conquering Eretz Yisrael, when he was doing the kibush v'chiluk, the 7 years of conquering the land of Israel, the 7 years of separating it, of giving it to the different tribes, he wanted to make it clear that Eretz Yisrael belongs to Klal Yisrael, not the specific tribe. You know, once he divided it, so they might have a special ownership, but really Klal Yisrael owns Eretz Yisrael belongs to everybody. And how did we made many takanas to do this, many institutions. One of the institutions of Yeshua was what the Gemara calls Meis Mitzvah Kona Mekomo, which means that, let's say, you find a dead body on the road, a corpse on the road, which wasn't uncommon then. Today we have cemeteries. During those days, you didn't really have cemeteries. People were buried on the roads in different places. So the Lachis Meis Mitzvah Kona Mekomo, if any person was found dead in Eretz Yisrael, so the Lacha was, you bury them right on the spot. They're entitled to the makam of Kvura, the place of burial. So the discussion among the Mefarshim, what's the nature of this halacha? Like, what was Yeshua getting at when he said, Meis Mitzvah Kona Mekomo? Who was it for? Was it Latovas HaMeis? Was it the honor for the dead? That every Jew deserves a burial, and therefore no matter where you are, we're not going to say, well, you have to wait till you get back to your chelek. No. Wherever you are, you die, you deserve a kvura meis mitzvah kona makomo. Or no, do we say it was with tovas hachayim? It's for the living. What do you mean for the living? Because what's going to happen? Oh, this person. No, I don't know. He shouldn't be buried there. Let's take him here. Let's move him there to avoid machlokes among the living. So therefore, Yoshua said, no, meis mitzvah kona makomo. That's it. You don't have to argue about this spot, wherever he is. That's where he's going. I don't care where he's from, where he's going. So is it l'tov asachayim? Is it for the living? Is it for the dead? And my nafkamina, what's the difference? Either way, we say that luck is if someone, you find a corpse on the road, you bury them in coma. What's the difference if it's l'kavad achayim or l'kavad ameis? So actually, we'll see. It was a very practical question after 1948 when we got the state of Israel. I'll come back to that in a second. Because the Gemara has a very interesting incident with Rabbi Akiva. That Rabbi Akiva, they say, the Gemara, he found a mace mitzvah. He found a corpse. And instead of burying it right there, he carried it about 3 miles, 2 miles, 5 miles, whatever the distance was. And he took it to a cemetery. He took it to a place where people were buried. And he expected when he got there, everyone would say, oh, wow, what a great mitzvah he did. In fact, they were all trashy. I'm like, what are you doing, Rabbi Akiva? They said, you should have left the body there. Meis mitzvah kona makomo. So that's a discussion among the Tosfos in different places. Why exactly were they upset about meis mitzvah kona makomo? Well, really, no. Was that why he was upset? No, because he was mevatel Torah. Different discussions in Tosfos. What exactly they were upset. But Rabbi Akiva took the body. So the issue is, if it's l'tova sachayim, if it's to avoid machlokes, then he had no right to take it. Because why? Because that's the whole reason Yeshua made the institution. People should argue, should it be buried there, here? That's the halacha. So he learns that it's a chi if you have to. But if it's a tovas hameis, which Rabbi Akiva assumed, so therefore he took a tovas hameis. I don't want to be buried somewhere on the road. Bury me in a cemetery. Bury me where people are going to come and know where I am. So that's the issue in terms of whether it's a rishus, it's an option, or it's mandatory. So it happened in 1948, and it probably could happen today as well. It wasn't an uncommon question that when the Jews are fighting in Lebanon or different parts outside of Eretz Israel, or even different parts of Eretz Israel, in the outskirts, so soldiers get killed in war and they get buried. So you bury this. So the question was, they asked after the war was over, they went to the Chazon Ish and said, well, what about my son who was buried out in the outskirts somewhere? And now I want to go ahead and bring him back to our kever avos. I want to bring him back to our family plot. So the Chazon Ish, as we'll see, the Chazon Ish said yes, that you can do that. And Rav Breich, a Rav from Switzerland, he felt strongly against it. He said, in general, we have a lacha of you're not allowed to enter a body, you know, at stomach. In general, it's covered ameis, once all things being equal, there are a lot of exceptions to the rule. But all things being equal, you don't move a body out of once you bury it. Assuming, because some say it's a discussion, you might have to do a new shiva again if the body's still there. The many issues with it, as a general rule, we agree. But the many exceptions. So he said, if the halacha meis mitzvah makomo said then, initially I had to bury them there, so how can I go ahead now and take them out? And the Chazon Ish said, no. It's true there's halacha meis mitzvah kona makomo, but that's only during the war. But now the war is over, it's no longer a meis mitzvah. Now people could go ahead now and bring him to the cemetery. So they have a base on the Chazon Ish, that was the minig, that most, so people took the body of the soldier and they moved him back to Kever Avos. Kever Avos, bringing him back to either Eretz Yisrael, bringing him back to your own Kever Avos, those are one of the exceptions to the rule, even brought down in Shulchan Aruch, that one is permitted to go ahead and inter the body. Yeah, Jeff? Yeah.
It's covered on mace. It's covered on mace to take that mokum and give him a better mokum. So we have covered on mace, and then you have the question of tzibur again. Whether if it's really covered on mace, it is also covered on tzibur. And the covered on tzibur was that we would not allow him in Lebanon. And the covered on tzibur is that the tzibur requires what's it's a leader of Zibor to give the covered mace towards a soldier that took on a whole new
dimension,
that the old principles were not violated. What you're saying, the old principles are at that time where it does not impact, let's say, if yes, a Kodomoko was on the road. Everybody's going with their horses and wagon. So you can't say you're going to bury him there on the road where the horses and wagons are going, or on the highway. You still have to move him. So therefore, the covered seymour means our obligation. And the covered amei takes on a new, that's what essentially the essence of the
chazalim. Very good. Any questions? Jeff?
Okay. I'm just curious. Why didn't, I don't know, we were the people refreshing Rabbi Akiva. Didn't he defend himself? Didn't he say, but?
You know, no, saying, yeah, so obviously he obviously felt that was his, but the point wasn't that they were, the point was that they're showing the two aspects. I was
okay,
they felt,
okay.
The Nakuda was, when we say Meis Mitzah Kol HaMakomo, is that an option or a Chiyah?
Oh, they were
so they felt that Meis Mitzah, you have to.
And he was saying
so right, he say because, but and then why? Because I'm saying why? Because they held it was covered achai. So if it's to avoid machlokas, you dafka can't do that. But if it's covered ameis, then what covered ameis is? Covered ameis is to bring them to the cemetery.
Okay, thank you.